Yo, Redmond, I have one question only. Okay, you in this camera business. What is this with your camera thing? That's the question. Let me ask you something. You ready for the question?
Mm-hmm.
I have your attention. Are you into this camera? What are you doing?
We're going to do it with the camera.
Let me get my blackie.
Let's see. There we are.
There we are.
Okay, actors. Let's see.
Okay, look, I got this
let
question.
Let me show my niece with it. Let me just show this first.
I want you to answer this question. Have you had therapy for this obsession?
No.
That's my only question.
No.
What do you mean you haven't had? Don't you think you're supposed to have some kind of therapy?
I have my brother's daughter. My dead brother's daughter.
Oh, that's a good picture right there. I like that one.
I babysit her.
Man, there's another question. How many people have you babysat in your life? Come on.
Oh, God.
Okay, don't answer the question. Okay, I'm sorry.
We still got to say, what do with your water you want to do?
No, this is your house.
I know it, but I know you.
Well, fly on the wall. We shouldn't mention flies these days because... I wanted to sleep on that bad boy. I didn't even see the fly, man. I wanted to sleep on that. Gotta go to bed early, man. Gotta get up early. Come on now. What's going on here, man? Let's start from not the beginning. Now you have how much collection do you have here? Number of pieces in your house right here, right now, about roughly.
If you look at what's on the wall and what's stuck around, yeah. I say in my house, pieces of what? You mean everything? I would say I have about 100,000.
In the house, right?
In the house.
Now.
You look at all the books.
Now let's.
All the closets.
Mm-hmm. Okay. That's the house. Now we got to go quickly.
Okay.
How many storage units do you have and how much of these storage units do you have?
I have 8 storage units. And
you know, 8 is the number for prosperity. You know that, don't you?
Yeah.
Okay, well, 8 storage
units. And maybe we can go out there and just peek in them. I don't know.
We don't peek in the storage units.
Yeah. Because you can just see when you walk, when you open the door, you see, you don't have to go around in there.
No.
We finally got it organized.
No, man, I have to spend like a year here, because I'm a bookstore junkie kind of person, you know what I mean?
Okay.
I wean myself off of bookstores lately,
nice.
You know? Like that, so. We're not finished yet. Hold on, that's 8 storage units. 8 storage units. Eight storage units of what?
Books. Letters. Writing, which is what?
I want to bring up white people, but you know, George Bernard Shaw once said, you know a man through his letters, and we don't write letters no more. So there's the problem. How are you going to know somebody these days? How do you know somebody these days? What would be the way?
Well,
since people don't write like that no more.
Zoom.
Can't do no Zoom, man. Can't do no Zoom. Okay, we did the 8 storage units. We get the piece. I'm not even counting. Now, you got to have a collection. What university, what institution has a lot of your works? That's holding some of your works. Yeah.
University of Illinois at Springfield. University of Alabama at Tuscaloosa. Schomburg. Now, Schomburg doesn't officially have any of my stuff, but when I went to look at exhibits, at holding.
Yeah.
Like, just say Larry Neal, for example.
Yeah.
I found photos.
Did you do?
For more than 50 years, I've sent people photos.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody you can name who's a writer, any black writer, and many of writers of other.
Yeah.
Huge. Mm-hmm. I've sent them whenever I left the conference. I just got my crew of students together, and you'll see something in the next room.
That's the point. That's what you have. See, the thing is, not only do you have institutional outlets or whatever, storage, whatever it is, but the thing is, you have, I won't say rolling stewards, but you have crews.
Yeah.
and therefore you can keep on sustaining your thing. And that's what people need. And usually people are trying to be so solo or so, you know.
One journalist wrote something a while back, and he said something, because I do tend to get the word out there, and people may see what I do as being a little smarmy.
Who? Smarmy.
Yeah, that's me, self-promoting.
Oh.
Or something like that. Anyway, but what he says is that he never moves alone. That's what this guy said. One thing, he never moves alone. When you see a spread of photos, he's going to have his mama in there. my mother been dead since I was nine. But you know, that kind of thing.
Talking street talk. Yeah, I get you.
And I do have pictures of myself, but I love this kind of thing, taking pictures like this.
The reason why I do this work here, right, that's everything. You know, I have a YouTube channel, right? It's not monetized. In fact, it's what's called Creative Commons. So therefore, YouTube does not send anybody to my channel, which is what I want. Because when I first go to YouTube, I do what the core mission is. YouTube to me was only an archival service. That's all it was, ever was. But here's what happened. A few years, I had my YouTube channel since I think 2011, but I didn't start really doing it to 2014. I kept on telling people, record your elders. Please go back way back when, you know, you're back in the 80s. I'm going like, record your elders. Nobody listens to me. And then here's what happens. Come about 2015 or 2012, somewhere, I suddenly realized, hey, you know something? No, I was talking to this guy. I kept on telling him. He said, are you writing this stuff down? You know, this African guy. He said, well, I said, no, I'm like this. And then I realized, it hit me like, I've been telling people to talk to their elders.
Yeah.
Now I'm an elder.
Yeah. Yeah. I think about that. I think about that a lot.
So I said, ain't nobody going to be talking to me. Nobody knows who I am. They don't know. Because there's a few of us that sort of, you're a little bit above the radar. But I mean,
but they will.
There's a few of us. No, but we don't want to be famous. That's the point. Like my man, Melvin Simmons, we record everything. We like below the surface. Like we know everything. You know what I mean? They kind of get like that. And it's a really interesting because we know a lot of people. I was thinking this other day. I'm sorry, I'm talking. You know, I'm a radio man. Talk.
No, it's fine.
Check this out. I'm just going to talk to the Rivers. You realize this hand, I've shaken hands with Daniel Chappie James, this hand. Moshe Dayan, this hand. Thomas Sankara, this hand. Kenneth Kaunda, this hand. You understand? I'm just talking about those generals like that. So what I'm trying to say is some people on the planet, you know, we're not trying to be famous. We're not trying to name drop or nothing like that. You know, everybody's shaking them, you know, somebody's hand, whatever it is. But here's what happened. Let me just deal with Moshe Dayan. That was when I was, a friend of mine was a Drew, and he was speaking the other day. When I came up to him, because I talked to everybody, you know, when Richard Leakey and his son was hanging out, I was talking to them. They excited, because back then, it's like when a black person come, they get really excited, you know what I mean? You all of a sudden, they start talking, you know? So Moshe Dayan, he went off on like, Ralph Bunch. He respected Ralph Bunch so much because of the whole Israeli, whatever. And it was really weird because when I got to the University of Cape Town, I realized that Ralph Bunch walked these corridors, this campus, you know what I mean? And then I started to think this whole thing about, they say that, you know, your molecules, if you, any place, your molecule somehow stays there. It's like, basically, it's the concept of God. I'm not going to go into this whole spiritual thing, but this is the concept of God. God is every place, but the molecule stays there. So in a weird sort of sense, shaking Moshe Dayan's hands, I know he shook hands with Ralph Bunch, but Ralph Bunch also walked his thing. So I got this double dose of Ralph Bunch. This is what's happening. This has nothing to do with reality. This is what happens in my head. You know what I mean? This is what, it's a weird kind of thing. I'm on the campus. There, Nelson Mandela went through here, and Oliver Tambo and Bishop, all these people went through this campus. So I feel like I keep on gathering all these molecules, if you will, you know? Mm-hmm. So anyway, I don't know. I just went off. I don't even know why I said that. No, I said it because of you.
I understand, yeah.
Think about that.
I am. I'm thinking about it. And there's a story behind every handshake and behind every path crossing. You know, and I've been doing quite a bit of that writing. I call it, you may have seen, sheltering in space instead of sheltering in place.
No. Shelter. You know how you pose go off. don't give no. You know, Quincy said one time, I was in some place where he was talking while he was doing something. It was some, I don't know, I think it was in like, I don't know, Oklahoma. I forget where. We were someplace way strange, you know what I mean? Now, somebody asked him a question. Well, Quincy, how do you do it? He says, well, I'll tell you what I do. Every morning, I get up. I'm saying, because you know Quincy. I sit behind that typewriter. It was a typewriter. Yeah. I sit behind that typewriter and look around. If there's a poet, if there's a poem out there, I catch that motherfucker. I said, that's what we're talking about. That's the secret. It was not even a secret. So, what's your process? What happens with you? Because it sounds to me like you're like a wordsmith too. So, what happens is, yeah, you know what I mean? A word will excite you. A syllable will excite you. I mean, what excites you? What gets your thing going?
Sound. Either sound emanates from me. It's a mental sound, a physical sound, auditory, internally auditory. Or it's external from outside of this immediate space, like what's happening in the car, an argument in a room next door, across the room, across the street. And I'm constantly looking for how I might associate sounds and how the sound actually have meaning, innate meaning, without, enunciatory meaning, you know, the, what we call it?
I guess you're going to talk about pure sound, vibration.
Yeah. Yeah,
but isn't that the same? Isn't that a jazz riff too? Because isn't that what Monk said? Thelonious Monk, he said, somebody asked him something. He opened his, you know, on the west side, by like, you know, back sugar, yeah, or whatever. Yeah. So not San Juan, whatever it was. He opens his window. And he says, "There's yeah, the West Side Highway."
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
You know, that yeah. Says that's where he get it from. Oh man. Hey, look, I don't want, let me shut this off, man.
No, I'm just
we can keep on talking.